So this next person asked, why shouldn't the potential of DNA damage from radiation therapy persuade patients towards surgery, which only causes mechanical damage?
Well, these are theoretical concerns. Damage to DNA and whatnot, of course, that's how they kill off the cancers, by damaging the DNA. And with seed implant radiation in particular, the radiation is encapsulated right inside the prostate. So normal tissues don't get exposed to the, quote, DNA damage. But I think the theoretical concerns need to be balanced by the practical realities. We've been giving radiation to people for 20 or 30 years now, and we've had a chance to observe what actually happens with this DNA damage that people talk about. And it turns out people do very well if they're treated by skillful radiation therapists. Radiation does have a very bad reputation because in the learning curve of radiation 20, 25 years ago, a lot of people were seriously burned, and those burns could be lifelong, quite tragically. And so people that have prostate cancer that are in their 60s and 70s have heard about these things. They've heard about patients that have had problems. But if modern radiation is being used, and it almost always is now, the side effect profile is just dramatically less than surgery. And the problems with surgery that the surgeons don't talk about, penile shrinkage, ejaculating urine, incontinence, impotence, unfortunately are not stressed in the whirlwind of diagnosis and fear and anxiety about the cancer. And only later does it surface that these problems are going to be lifelong.
So this next question comes from a patient who had prostatectomy. So they had surgery. And this was back in October of 2020, when directly their next follow-up PSA was 0.07. And 5 months later, it's still 0.07. And they're getting concerned that the PSA hasn't gone straight down past that. So is there a concern that they should have? And should they address this with their doctor rather quickly?
So small amounts of PSA after surgery could be due to the fact the surgeon was unable to remove the prostate in its entirety. It's not easy to cut a prostate out, and to leave a little speck or portion of the prostate behind is not uncommon, and it can be detected with these low levels of PSA. As long as the PSA is not steadily rising, it's perfectly reasonable to just keep an eye on it, and it may just remain at that level indefinitely. It's certainly important to look at the profile of this person. If they started their surgery with a PSA of 25 and a Gleason 9 and seminal vesicle invasion, we already know that that person's in trouble. On the other hand, if they had a 3+4 with PSA of 4 and underwent surgery, then our expectations for cure are very, very high. So the background would be important in trying to determine the relevance of the PSA of 0.07. But as long as the PSA is not rising, from what little we know, we can continue watching it.
Is there any sort of scans that somebody can do after that in order to tell whether there was some bit of the prostate left behind?
Sometimes that is a issue, and people can be running around with somewhat higher PSAs that don't change, 0.1, 0.2, 0.3. And so an MRI or an ultrasound, and of course now with these new PSMA PET scans, the process of searching for the cause can be aided by these scans, although sometimes the residual prostate tissue wouldn't be visible. It's not a straightforward issue, and I think it's how the PSA behaves over time that is really going to drive the storyline.
Hi everyone, it's Alex and Hunter. Hunter's our official PCRI mascot. If you'd like to learn more about men's health tips and prostate cancer, you can follow him on Instagram, Sir Hunter the Dow. And also subscribe to our YouTube channel. We come out with new prostate cancer videos every week. Say bye!